Today's theme begins a pair of sermons. Today we talk about how to die. Next week, how to live. And today's theme was assigned to me by Susan Solon, who won the opportunity to do so at the last fantasy auction. I was grateful for this theme, that it was how to die rather than how to kill. But also because it's a theme with which I have wrestled with many a year. What could be more natural for someone who was born Irish Catholic than to speak of death? Mary Daly, the author, once said she had parents, one who was Irish Catholic, one who was Jewish. What she learned from her parents is this, quite simply, that the Jews know how to live and the Irish know how to die. I suppose it was a very wise person who noted some time ago that it's not death that we fear, but the actual act of dying. Think about that. Most of us have contemplated death when we began to realize that people die, pets die, and then we began to comprehend the larger truth: all people die. Therefore, all whom we love will die. And the grimmest, most real moment of all, that I myself must die too. To quote Jim Morrison, no one gets out of here alive. On that same theme, there have been many comedians who have made careers speaking of death. One of my favorite happens to be Woody Allen. And Woody Allen made the observation that he's not afraid of dying. He just doesn't want to be there when it happens. In my lifetime, I have conducted about 100 memorial services and funerals. I have been with people as they died, both personally, members of my family, friends and co-workers, and members of the congregations that I have served. That doesn't make me an expert per se on how to die, but it has taught me much about the rituals that so many cultures and families have invented and passed through the generations to give meaning to that reality of death. To talk about those rituals would be the subject of another sermon. I have books on my shelf in my office that describe all the intricacies and the delicate beauty that accompanies the dead and the families as they accompany the dead to their final journey. But today I want to talk specifically about how to die. A large part of how to die depends on the circumstances of one's death. There's not much one can say about sudden, unexpected death. I've known people who have died quite suddenly and tragically in car accidents, for example, who did not have time to prepare to die. It caught them very unexpectedly, and it traumatized the survivors. So I'm not really focused on that. More so, I'm talking about people who have lived a life, have accomplished certain milestones in their life, and are faced with the fact that their life is now coming to an end. Now, there are, of course, those people who choose to end their lives by their own hand. And sometimes they do so with a sane mind, and they choose the timing and circumstances with which they will depart this life. In our lifetime, we have seen many transitions. The name Dr. Kevorkian, of course, is a name with which most of us are familiar with. And so we know that in this time, physician-assisted suicide has become one of the great end-of-life issues. For a person who has lived a full life, but is facing a terminal illness, and in particular, an illness accompanied by pain, that sometimes that is the path that individuals will choose. But it's still extremely controversial. Less controversial is the situation when you have an individual who is in hospice, someone who is dying of a particular disease, and certain measures have been taken to offer that individual a measure of comfort. Now, in my professional training and career, I have accompanied those individuals as they journeyed from life through sickness to death. Some individuals have made their peace with the fact that they are going to die, and perhaps they have been able to do so by the work of Dr. Kubler-Ross, which again in our lifetime represents a milestone of understanding the process of death and the stages of dying and coming to terms with one's death. It's a powerful, powerful insight, and perhaps the shamans of old understood that, but now it is available to the mass culture. I'm also aware, and I thank you, Wes, for mentioning having seen Kansas, that in our pop culture, which celebrates youth and vitality, there has been a strain of music permeating my growth from adolescence to the present day, which has kept the notion of death in my consciousness and perhaps in yours. Perhaps some of you will remember such tunes as Funeral for a Friend by Elton John. Perhaps you listen to Don't Fear the Reaper by Blue Oyster Cult. Perhaps you listen to She Said by the Beatles. She Said, I Know What It's Like to Be Dead. Or contributed by the group Kansas, Dust in the Wind. In the pop culture, which, as I mentioned, does celebrate youth and vitality, some have had the higher consciousness to remind us that we are, in fact, mortal beings. And like the ancient Romans, they whisper in our ear as we travel in our triumph that thou art mortal, and from dust thou came, and to dust thou shalt return. Now, in our particular tradition, Unitarian Universalism, we celebrate life, and we talk about how there is a bird, borrowing from the Buddhist and the Hindu traditions, that life is like a bird that flits from the darkness of mystery into one window, into a brief space of light, and then flits out another window into another mystery, equally profound as from whence it came. And we focus on what does it mean to be alive? What is the purpose of life? What good can we construct in our personal lives and to others? But we don't really focus on the fact that with every breath we take, we are one breath closer to death. And so the question becomes again, how to die? Each one of us, by virtue of being alive, is by definition one breath closer to death. And assuming that we will have an opportunity to recognize the fact that death is imminent at some stage of our lifetimes, how do we embrace it? Do we do it as though it were an unwelcome intruder, or do we greet it as though it were an old friend? Part of the answer, of course, depends on what do you suppose happens after we die? Do you subscribe to the notion that we shall be born again? That the essence of our consciousness, of our soul, if we may call it such, will continue to exist after our physical being has ended, and that it will be transferred somehow to another being, and that the process of passing our life, like passing the light from one candle to another, continues almost through all eternity. Perhaps you believe that when we draw our last breath, do we fall asleep? Will we rest in peace? Will dying be just like falling asleep, from which we shall never rise? Something painful, an interruption, annihilation. Or do we fall asleep, and at a certain appointed judgment day, do we spring back from the graves and have our physical being cleaved back onto our bones, and we face some sort of judgment, Odds are that most people in this room were taught something akin to that, that there was a final judgment, perhaps when there would be a parade of all human history, and we would be reunited with those who have passed away. Odds are that most of us were taught and initiated into such a belief structure, but odds are also very high that most of us have moved beyond that particular notion. I find it very interesting and very telling that Unitarian Universalists, by and large, choose to be cremated. 90% of us will choose that. Only 10% will choose to be buried. Perhaps it is because we have a sense of ecological consciousness and we want to become one with nature. Seeing nature as a continuum stretching from the very beginning of this universe until its end, and that our atoms, given to us from the stars, will eventually be returned to the larger universe, and perhaps if there was a Big Bang, perhaps there will be a large joining of all energy and matter at the end of time, that we will once again be joined in an instant, and then another Big Bang, and our energy and essence will be spilled forth back into a universe to fill it up again. So what we think happens upon our death matters, because it will color whether we embrace this death or whether we rage against the dying of the light, as Dylan Thomas's poem spoke of. We will also wonder whether or not this is inescapable, but that it's also good, inherently good. Regardless of whether what happens after we've closed our eyes, that the natural process is inherently good. And there's much literature from the ancients as well as modern day poets who accept that particular vision. My favorite happens to be from the book of Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes, you may know, means the preacher. And there is the wonderful poem that begins, "For everything there is a season, a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die." And it tells us, like so much other poetry and so much other music, that this is part of the process. It's not good, it's not bad. It's just the way it is. And so we are left with, again, how do we face that? I mentioned Dylan Thomas. I could also mention one of my favorite authors, who is Robert Ingersoll. And Robert Ingersoll wrote some poetry to describe what happens as you stand and say your final farewells. And there's a poem that he wrote, which I've often used at memorial services and funerals. It's probably back over there, but I'll look again to see if it's here. There it is. Robert Ingersoll, as you may know, was considered the great agnostic. Some called him Pope Bob 100 years ago. And he was an evangelical agnostic, the most famous orator of his day. And he wrote this to be read at a memorial service of a young girl, the daughter of a friend of his who died when she was about 8 years old. And it reads thusly: "I know how vain it is to gild a grief with words, and yet I wish to take from every grave its fear. Here in this world, where life and death are equal kings, all should be brave enough to meet what all the dead have met. Why should we fear that which will come to all that is? We cannot tell, we do not know which is the greater blessing, life or death. We cannot say that death is not a good. We do not know whether the grave is the end of this life or the doorway of another, or whether the night here is not somewhere else a dawn. Every cradle asks us whence, and every coffin whither. It may well be that death gives all there is of worth to life. If those we press and strain within our arms could never die, perhaps that love would wither from the earth. It may be that common fate treads from out the paths between our hearts the weeds of selfishness and of hate. And I had rather live and love in a world where death is king than have eternal life where love is not. From 1882. In my lifetime, as I mentioned, I have had the privilege to accompany various people as they've journeyed through illness, facing death. And there are two stories that I'd like to share. Studies in contrast. One was a man named Herb. Herb worked for my father. He was 52 years of age. Incidentally, that's how old I am today. Herb worked for my father, pushing a broom, cleaning up the dust of the floor of the printing company. At the time, I was selling printing. It was the family business. Herb was ancient by my standards. I was about 25. But Herb became very sick. He had cancer. It was described as a spider cancer that spread throughout his entire body. My father didn't think much of my abilities as a salesman, so he assigned me during work hours to drive Herb to his various medical appointments. So I got to know him rather well, driving him from appointment to appointment, waiting with him, and getting to know this man who, as I said, had a rather lowly position. And I discovered that he lived only a block and a half from where I was living. Herb had been an artist. He had painted quite a few canvases in his day. He had been married. He had been divorced. I never learned all the particulars about his life, but I knew that those closest to him for the majority of his lifespan had turned their back on him in his final 2 years. He lived in a shanty. That's the best way I can describe his apartment. It was horrible. I hated going into that room. He had a few canvases left, and the people who were his friends at that point were myself, several people who were his co-workers, and his immediate neighbors. His children, his former wife, would have nothing to do with him. And again, I never learned all the details. But I fancied myself something of a graphic artist at the time, and so we talked about art. We talked about what his life was, or what it was to go through that illness. We talked about what type of food he liked. When he died, I was one of about four people to show up at his funeral. There was the funeral director, myself, and two other people from work, and that was it. And it was the most lonely day that I had experienced. It was awful. We barely had enough manpower to carry his coffin to the graveside. And I thought, what a tragic end to a life. And I thought, this was no way to die. Practically alone, abandoned by the people who had accompanied you on your journey, not really having any kind of resolution to whatever tragedies or mistakes he had made, but just to facing death and having death overwhelm him, and then forgotten, except by those who remembered him. And it was that particular experience that really moved me to consider ministry. Because I saw in myself, there but for the grace of God, could have gone I. That any individual who has not made amends, who has not accepted one's faults and sought to redress one's mistakes, one who has not known joy or given joy to others, there but for the grace was I at the age of 25. And it shook me up. And again, as I say, it started me on this path. The other individual was my brother, my older brother Brian, who about 11 years ago developed a cancer. And he was informed at the time that it was already stage 3, mantle cell lymphoma. Now, my brother and I had been competitors most of our lives. We had some wonderful moments. We had some ugly moments. But we were loyal competitors to each other. And when he was given this notice, it transformed the dynamics in our relationship, but also in our family. Now, my brother aggressively pursued treatment. I don't know if I would have been as aggressive as he was, but he was. And he was married and had several sons, some of whom were very, very young. And I do not doubt that he raged and raged against the dying of the light, in large part for his children's sake. And so he fought it tooth and nail. And he reached various milestones of medical treatment. And he passed through chemotherapy and radiation and all these new experimental drugs, which seemed to ruin him physically and mentally at some stages. And yet his toughness and his resilience kept coming to the fore, and he fought this death. At one stage, about 3 years ago, our family had a dinner. It was about Halloween. And so it was just for immediate family, my parents and my siblings and I. And we sat around the table and we had what could well have been the last supper of our family as a whole together. And we talked about my brother and his wife and his children. And we talked about what it was like for him to be dying. He had opportunities at that dinner, as well as other family events, to say goodbye. And I think over the decade, he's gotten actually very good at it. But it hasn't overshadowed the joy he has had for life and the privilege he has experienced in being alive. But to return to that particular dinner, there were some very funny moments. He made a terrible joke at my expense. And I leaned forward and said, "Brian, you're going to hell for that." But we also had some very somber moments. And we all made a pledge that we would do what we could to help his family, both in real material terms, in spiritual terms, and mentoring when the day came when he would die. Now, I'm pleased to say that he's still alive, and whether it's can be credited to his stubbornness or to the advancements in medical technology or a combination of the two, c'est la vie. He is still alive, but still precariously on that thin edge separating life and death. He's on that razor's edge of illness, which any day, any month, he could go either way. A year ago, we had a family gathering, and we thought we were going to lose him again. We were at a Cubs game. And I tell you, nothing quite prepares you for death as being a Cubs fan. But we were at this game, and halfway through, he began to cough up blood, and he had to be removed by the paramedics. And again, we thought we were losing him. And so my experience of being with my brother and being with Herb have taught me much about what it means to go to death empty-handed, without really taking stock of your life, without having measured the joy that you have known or that others have known because of you, without accepting your mortality and embracing and celebrating your life. And I contrast that with my brother, who has fortunately been able to do all that. And so I encourage all of us in the time that we have left to celebrate our being, to take measure of our lives, to think on those things, because sometimes death does come like a thief in the night. And sometimes it is awful when it comes and unexpected. And so to use our time so at least we know and perhaps share with others what you have learned from your life and what you wish your legacy might be remembered as. And share that. But most precious of all, use your time well. And by that, I mean say thank you. Thank you to the men, women, and children, to the animals who have made a difference in your lives. Say thank you. Let them know that they were appreciated. That cannot be understated. But just as equally important, have an opportunity for people to say thank you to you. It's extraordinary the effect it will have on you. And if you have had the opportunity to express your gratitude and been open to receiving gratitude, it can really transform your vision of life, and death will lose its sting in part. Life is like a bird that passes from the darkness and mystery and flits for a few instances in sunlight and then removes itself through another window. That is very true. So when we come to die, let us greet it not as a stranger, not as something that stings, not as something that steals or smothers us, but let us greet it as an old friend and make our peace with it. So may it be.